put the who's it on the what's it. Attach the what's it to the who's it. Connect the thingamajig to the thingamabob, and that'll make the whatchamacallit.
All right, welcome back to Making Records. I'm Eric Valentine. This week we're going to do something a little different. I'm working on some great production deconstructions with some awesome guests that I'm super, super excited about. Until then, you're stuck with me, and that means it's going to get super nerdy. So I recently changed, you know, my mixing situation, and I did a record at the beginning of this year, and when it came time to mix, I'd been mixing a little more in the box, you know, using hardware inserts for some of my favorite outboard pieces. And for this most recent record, I felt like I want this to feel a little more like I'm mixing on a console. And I still wanted to use a very simple setup, be able to stay here in Topanga, be close to my family. And so I decided to build myself a passive summing mixer. I looked into some of the options out there for doing that, and none of the ones that are out there really do what I think a mixer needs to do. When I mix on a console, there are multiple stages of summing that happen. It's not just a mix bus. I don't know if anybody mixes that way. It's quite often that you'll have a drum mix and you need that to be summed together into a stereo signal, and then you can compress that or EQ it or put some sort of processing on it, and then that comes in and blends in with the rest of the instruments, and then maybe that comes out and gets compressed for the, you know, overall mix bus. I've actually been separating the music bus from the vocal bus, so all of the music, drums, bass, guitars, whatever's in there, that comes out, gets compressed together, and then the vocals will get blended in with that, so that's another summing stage, to create the final stereo mix that gets captured on a tape machine or in the computer. So there's at least three stages of summing that are necessary the way I like to, you know, set up the busing structure on an analog console when I'm mixing. There's no, I couldn't find any passive summing mixers that that did that, so I built one. And so we're going to talk a little bit about the process of doing that, the concept of having these multiple stages, how that all ties into the computer. I have an example here that we can listen to. I always like to have something to hear, so I'm not just here blabbing the whole time. You can hear the difference. Let's start there. Let's hear something first. This is a project, a super talented guy named Spencer Lee. It's called the Spencer Lee Band. I worked with him on and off over a few years while he was trying to get everything together. And this was the first thing that we did together. He sent me a demo. It was just him and a little acoustic guitar, a little miniature acoustic guitar, him singing on top of it. And it was so cool. His vocal was so amazing on this. I was like, oh my God, I'd love to be involved with this. And so he gave me the demo. I took the original acoustic guitar and looped it and then played drums and bass and clavinet and a bunch of stuff to it. So I'll play a little bit of that, and then we'll get into all the differences and stuff that ended up happening with the mixing.
Stars above, I want to see you underneath. been taking over my mind every single night and day. What's a man gotta do?
So you get the idea. It's kind of a Bill Withersy vibe there. I did my best to get my James Gadson on. Man, what an incredibly fun project to work on. His voice is just so incredible. He's so soulful. Young guy from Kansas that was just born with a voice, you know, one of those things. So I love that transition in the song when the drums and the clavinet, everything comes in. The first time I played it for him, he just about, you know, jumped across the room. He was so excited about it. It was a really fun moment. So I worked on the song. I mixed it a while ago. I actually did not have this passive summing mixer when I did the mix that was delivered and is now on Spotify and out in the world. I kind of wish I did have it because I pulled it up again and really for this demonstration because the project that I built the summing mixer for is not out yet. It's not going to be out until later this year, so I can't use any of that material. We'll hopefully get into that later. So I revisited this mix using the passive summing mixer so we could just hear what that's like. And then... recreated the mix in the box using the same outboard gear, but doing it all with hardware inserts, all the summing done digitally in the computer. And it was very interesting. I actually got some unexpected results on this that I was not anticipating. So this was kind of fun for me. So let's do a little bit of A-Bing first, and we'll do it from where all the action starts here, and the band comes in. So this is the summing mixer, analog world. There's various outboard processing stuff going on. There's a pair of distressors on the drum mix. I'm using these Altec 436Cs on the vocal mix. And then the overall mix has an Unfairchild on it. So those are the three outboard devices that were used, you know, in the process of summing this thing. And then we'll talk about how they're applied in each stage and all that stuff. But check out the difference between doing it out of the box and in the box. So this is out of the box.
Well, darling, I got some things to say. You've been
in the box.
In and out and taking over my mind every single night and day. What's a man gotta say?
Out of the box.
Do be, please just tell me again. I'll take you to the kissing tree. I got too many things
in the box. So it's pretty close. Not a dramatic difference there. There is a small difference. I hear with the out-of-the-box version, things are sort of blended together. It's a little more seamless sounding. I do kind of, at a certain point, feel like I'm repeating myself with all these like analog to digital comparisons, but that's the best language I can come up with to describe it. The individual instruments seem like they're locked and focused in their places better with the out-of-the-box mix. The in-the-box mix, in some ways, is actually a little more present. But things are a little more disconnected from each other. And so it could be more of, a subjective choice. If you want something where, all the individual items are more stark and not sort of like smoothed together as much, then the in-the-box summing, I think, it could be a good choice for me, and really the aesthetic that I was going for with this project, and the project that I ultimately, built this summing mixer for. I definitely wanted that more sort of like glued together, nostalgic sort of vintage sound. So it does seem to do that. So let's talk a little bit about what's happening here. So the summing mixer, I'll show you a little bit about how this thing came about. It started off, with an idea. I came up with a faceplate design, and here's the printouts for it. I had to print it three different ways just so I could figure out how to lay everything out on the panel. I'm essentially prototyping this summing mixer and building only one of them, because I've been through this process with Undertone of coming up with an idea for a thing and then figuring out how to manifest it as a physical item that exists. You know, there are certain steps in that process that make it a lot easier. And so I use things like Adobe Illustrator. I use a 3D CAD software to lay things out. I didn't need that for this, but I did use Adobe Illustrator to do this stuff. And so you can see the faceplate layout. That's this here that I printed up. And then this is the backside of it. And there's these green parts are representing prototyping circuit boards, and each one of these has a copper trace that goes all the way across. It's specifically designed for creating buses. If you're designing a circuit, you know, that needs that sort of thing, these circuit boards make it really easy to do that. And then I would jumper them together to create a bus all the way across the back here. And this is where the little switches will mount, and then they will tie in to the buses. This one here is a wiring guide that I printed up because I've had a lot of experiences in the past. If I'm wiring a patch bay or something, if I don't have a guide in front of me and I'm trying to actually figure out what wire goes where while I have a hot soldering iron in my hand, it's very easy to make mistakes. And so I will make a guide. So all I have to do is look at the guide that tells me this wire goes from here to there. And I don't have to think about it at all. I'm not trying to figure it out. I'm just following the guide, and I created the guide at a time when I was very focused on it and was able to make sure there was no mistakes. So then here it is starting to come together. You can see all these gray hill double pole, double throw toggle switches that take the incoming signal and then feed them into these little breadboards that have the traces that go all the way across them. And so, you know, like this is, I even put labels on the back side of the panel so I'd know this is the kick drum, this is the snare drum. When I used to wire patch bays, I'd make the mistake all the time where I'd turn the patch bay around and start wiring left to right the way it looks from the front and be starting from the wrong side, because when you turn it back around, what's on the left, that's the last patch point. That's not the first one. And I screwed that up so many times, I would have to start over. And so I started using labels so I wouldn't be confused about that either. So there you can see all the wires going into the circuit boards. Here's these jumper cables that make it really easy to extend these boards from one to the other. And so here you can start seeing it coming together. So now the circuit boards are mounted on some standoffs. And so there's room for the wires to fit underneath the board, and they come up through here, and then I would solder the points right there. I can zoom in a little bit. And so I just poke the wire through from the other side, throw a little solder on, snip off the excess, and we've got basically a signal connected to a bus. You can see these copper traces that travel all the way across. That's what connects all of these signals together and turns it into a bus. And so it goes all the way across, and you can see with my labels, it's covered up by the wire now, but you know, this is the kick and snare. These are stereo drum inputs for two different stereo drum mixes that I can blend in. And then this becomes a duplicate of the kick and snare that go directly into the music bus in case I don't want to actually compress the drums separate, you know, before it mixes in, blends in with the music bus. And then this is, you know, stereo inputs for individual instruments, a miscellaneous input. Yeah, I'll go back and describe this stuff a little better when we're not looking at a bunch of, you know, blank solder points here. So here's just more shots of what this thing looks like. That's a good shot of the jumper cables that extend stuff. There's the stuff coming in. So along here, this is basically the outputs of the summing buses. Summing buses don't really have a polarity to them. You can connect it on the front side or on the other end or anywhere along there. You could connect wires to actually feed the signal into mic preamps that will make up the gain. And then this rather messy looking, you know, bunch of wiring is my grounding. So it ended up working out fine, and there was a tiny bit of hum, but I had to do it this way in case I needed to isolate the grounding of some of the mic preamps that I was using, because different mic preamps do it different ways, and there could have caused some ground looping and stuff. I ended up being able to leave all the grounding connected. It was super easy and was plenty quiet for doing mixes. So it all worked out. Let's see what else we got down here. Okay, yeah, so there's the front panel. I can talk a little more about how this actually, you know, goes together. So these six toggle switches right here would be the drum mix. And so there, when I'm using a system like this, there's still quite a bit of mixing going on in the computer. So I'm EQing stuff in the computer, and really things are coming out here. Like if I want to do individual treatments of the kick and snare, if I wanted to use, you know, outboard EQ and compression on the kick and snare, I can do that here. And then I have stereo stuff here. So if I wanted to compress the overhead mics, you know, with a specific outboard compressor, I could do that here. And then I have another stereo input for drums where it can be like toms and room mics and stuff, and hopefully other things that don't need individual processing. So then this whole blend actually dumps back in here. So it would get fed into these toggle switches, which blend the drums in with the rest of the music. And so there's a spot here for an individual instrument. So if I needed to compress the guitar or a piano or something, and I wanted to use outboard stuff, I could do that with one of these stereo inputs. And then this miscellaneous, this is basically everything else that's coming out of Pro Tools that doesn't need any sort of external processing. That all shows up here. So the drums blend in with this stuff and gets passed on to the next summing stage, which is the final mix stage. All the music shows up here. I'll talk about this a little bit. Occasionally, I don't need to compress the drums individually, you know, as a summed mix. Sometimes I'll just blend the drums in with the other instruments. That whole thing gets compressed together. And the drums don't need that extra layer of compression. And so when I'm doing that, I have the option of turning on the drums in the music bus, and I don't use these at all. And so the drums just get mixed in directly with all the various Pro Tools stuff, any individual things that I'm processing. That becomes all of the music stuff, which shows up here. And I have the option of compressing that stereo mix. So here is the vocal stuff. I have the option of doing a specific processing of the vocals. This is a mono input right here. I can have the lead vocals show up there, use an Unfairchild or some sort of outboard EQ, a Pultec or something, process the vocals the way you would more on a, you know, old, you know, vintage console or something. And then I have stereo vocals here. Sometimes it's stereo effects for the lead vocals, or it's stereo background vocals, stuff like that. All of this stuff, in this case, got compressed by the Altec compressors, and that shows up there. So then you have all the compressed music, which got compressed with the Unfairchild in this instance, all the vocals, which got compressed with the Altecs. Those blend together to create the final stereo mix. In this instance, the drums did go through the drum mix bus, and they got compressed with a pair of distressors. So that's really the concept here, is that you get the busing architecture of, you know, a large format console, but there's just no EQs and aux sends and all that stuff that's really actually being handled by the computer. And I just needed those multiple cascading stages of busing in order to actually do this the way I normally would, without having to go out of the computer and back in again and out of the computer and back in again, and have all of these conversions happening. So So there it is. You can see a close-up of the beautiful faceplate. That's basically just photo paper printed out of an inkjet printer and glued onto, with spray glue, onto a metal plate. And then I drilled it with a drill press and mounted all the toggle switches in there. You got yourself a multi-stage summing mixer. It does require a lot of mic preamps. So this summing mix here, that requires two mic preamps, stereo signal. Then it gets blended in with all the music. Then that gets summed. That requires a pair of mic preamps. The vocals, those get summed together. That requires a pair of mic preamps. And then the final mix, that also requires a pair of mic preamps. So you need 8 channels of mic preamps in order to make this thing work. It's not that different than a real console. All of these summing stages will have a summing amplifier and something that's making up the gain. And so in this case, I'm just doing it with external mic preamps. And the cool thing is that I was able to play with different flavors of mic preamps to see really what, you know, was going to sound cool. I tried like old Altec tube mic preamps, and I tried, of course, Undertone stuff, and I have a whole rack of these Neve, 1081 style preamps. And so I ended up using a combination of those. In this case, it's, Neves for the drums and the music bus. And the vocal bus, and then the very last stage, the final mix bus, I used a pair of the Undertone mic preamps. So that's the basic idea for how this thing works. I can show you a little bit about how it came together here. So, we have drum stuff here. Here's the drum bus, and it's going out of my Lynx Aurora converter. And so here, let's just grab all the drum stuff. So that stuff is coming out of outputs 3 and 4, showing up right here on the mixer. But this is actually really important. Before it gets to the inputs of the summing mixer, there's a really important thing that happens. And I'll pull up a picture of the patch bay layout, because this helps do this. I was really excited about how all of this worked, because I wanted to do this as like plug and play and affordable and as uncomplicated as possible. So I just bought Hosa, DB25 snakes, cut off one end, and dressed the bare wires so I could solder them onto the switches. The patch bays have DB25s in the back, so I did have to solder onto the switches, but after that point, literally just plugged stuff into the back of the patch bay. Everything normals, so this summing mixer works without having to plug in a single patch cable. The only patch cables that I have to plug in are when I want to add processing to it. I didn't want to have a situation where every time I want to start mixing something with a mixer, I have to patch in a bunch of cables to make it work. So this is how that happens. And it's going to introduce a very, very important part of this. It's really the only thing that actually made this possible for me. So here are the outputs of the Lynx Aurora converter. So I have 16 channels of it. And they go into this device called Summation. It was made by this incredibly clever, brilliant guy named Scott Grenier. And what it is a computer-controlled automation system where you can patch signal into it, and it goes through a VCA that you can control with a software plug-in controller that's automatable in Pro Tools, so you can control the level, and then it comes back out. I just use it as a level controller that I can actually automate with the computer. And so this is the point at which I would insert the processing, especially if I'm using a compressor. If I'm using it, that was the other thing about summing mixers that was like, this just doesn't fucking work, because I'm mostly coming out of the computer to use, vintage compressors and things that I love. If I can't control the level after the compressor, it doesn't do me any goddamn good. You know, if I'm trying to change the level of my lead vocal when it's going to an 1176 or an Unfairchild, the compressor is undoing all of the level changing that I'm doing, and it's changing the amount of compression on whatever the item is, whether it's a vocal or drums or whatever. And so you have to be able to control the level after the processing, before it goes into the summing mixer. It's the only way this works. And this summation box does that. Sadly, Scott is not actually making these anymore, but if you want one, he had actually went to SSL and showed him his idea. They loved it because they stole the idea, and it's now their Sigma thingamajig. So that does the same thing. If you, any of you are brave enough to want to go down this rabbit hole, that's what you would use to do it. I use Scott Grenier's. It sounds incredible. He did a beautiful job with the software control of it and the whole thing. So basically what happens is signal comes out of the Lynx I/O. In this case, it's outputs 3 and 4. It goes to my distressors, and then I patch it back in right here. You can see that patch happening on the actual patch bay right here. So here it is going to the distressors. Oh, actually, it went to a couple of EQs as well. Comes back from the distressors into the summation inputs. So then I can adjust the level of the drum mix after the compression. And so then the output of summation normals to the input of this stereo drum bit right here. And so then that summed output shows up right here. Here's drums of the summed outputs. That normals to the input of whatever mic preamps I have tied into the patch bay. In this case, a pair of Neve 1081 style mic preamps. And so then those preamp outputs go to drum output, which show up now right here on the summing mixer. And so those can be blended in with the rest of the music, which in this case, I didn't do any individual instruments. I'm only using the miscellaneous input, which is all of the other instrumentation that's happening in this song. And so that's this miscellaneous bit right here. And so then all of this miscellaneous stuff plus the drum information, that shows up at the music summed output. And then that goes to, it normalizes to another set of preamps. And then the vocals normalize to another set of preamps. And so everything normalizes to their respective mic preamps that make up the gain. It's 35 dB of gain. And then all of that ultimately gets summed for this final preamp output, where these last preamps, you know, show up here. That's the final summed mix output. In this case, it goes to my my Lavery converter to get back into the computer, or it would go to my ATR 102 tape machine to get captured through a tape machine. So that's basically the whole concept, you know, that everything's super easy. It's just DB25 cables. They plug right into the back of the patch bays. Everything normals into its next stage where it needs to go. I can insert processing where I want it. It was a very ergonomic, you know, super easy setup to use when I mixed this whole last record. I really, really enjoyed it. This is probably going to be my setup for the foreseeable future. So all that ends up back in here. Here's the drums. And you can see right here, this is the controller for the summation automation. All I had to do was turn the drums down a little bit right there. And, let's see if I'm actually doing any moves. I am doing some moves on the drums. So after the compression, I wanted to turn it up on these big hits. And so when the drum, and so I'm using the automation to do that. If I didn't have this, I would be just turning up the drums into the compressor. So they wouldn't necessarily get a lot louder. They would get more compressed. But this way, with this system, I'm able to actually automate it the way I would on a console. So you can hear those moments in the song. They're these big, one at a time. Yeah, so those moments, you know, I'm pushing the drums, I'm pushing everything right there. So those moments are real big. So then that's pretty much it. I guess I can show you how the whole thing gets figured out. There's a formula that's used in order to figure out the resistor values. And so I came up with that with Larry. I talked through all this stuff with Larry Jasper. I'm very fortunate. He's the circuit designer for Undertone Audio. So if I'm ever unsure about anything, I can always call him and I know for sure it'll be right. And so this is the spreadsheet that I use to calculate the resistor values. So this is saying what I want the input impedance to be for my passive summing mixer. So anything that's being plugged into this is going to see a 10,000 ohm input impedance. That's a nice place to be. A lot of line inputs are 10,000 ohms. It doesn't put, you know, a significant load on the output of whatever is going into it. This is what I want the output impedance to be coming from a summed bus on the passive summing mixer. So like, let's say the output of the drum mix, I want that to be 182 ohms because this has to go into a mic preamp. The inputs of mic preamps generally have a lower input impedance. It can be anywhere from 1500 to 2500 ohms, something like that. So it's good to have a lower output impedance. And that's where this shunt resistor comes in. That needs to be calculated in order to make sure all of these bus outputs end up with this same impedance, because that ultimately determines how much gain makeup you're going to have to do. And I want them to be consistent. So I can set all my preamps to 35 dB and everything will come back basically unity. And so that gets calculated here based on the number of channels that are being summed. So in this case, you know, if we look at the mixer here, let me pull that up again. So for like the drum submix, for the left side, there's four signals that are being summed. So there's the kick, the snare, because those are going both to left and right. So on the left side, this is going to the left side, this is going to the left side. Here's the left of the first stereo drums, left of the second stereo drums. So that's four channels that need to be summed together. And so I would just go here, type in four to the number of channels. It recalculates everything. And so the output of the summing mixer without the shunt resistor, so what it naturally is, it's basically pretty obvious here. It's 10K divided by 4. And so you get 25 ohms as your output impedance. That's way too high to drive a mic preamp. So you have to put a shunt resistor on there. And so you're basically paralleling a resistor with this impedance in order to achieve 182 ohms. And so this formula you can see here, it's a bunch of reciprocals. That's how you figure out paralleling resistors. And so it is the reciprocal of B2, which is the output impedance that you want, and D4, which is the actual impedance that's coming out of the summed bus. And so you subtract the reciprocal of B2, you subtract the reciprocal of D4 from B2, and then you take the reciprocal of that. It's stupid. I don't even know why I even talked about all of that. I'm already bored just having said it. But that's how you figure it out. And so I needed to order a 196 ohm resistor in order to put across the plus and minus of the output of this bus, and that would give me 182 ohms. So, you know, when you parallel 196 ohms with 25 ohms, it gives you 182 ohms. So then that means, you know, 35 dB of makeup will get you very close to unity, and it actually worked. It was great. Once I wired it all up and fixed all my little, you know, messy solder points and stuff and tested everything and put it through a mic preamp, and I was like, hey, look at that. It actually came out about zero. This is kind of incredible. So that's how it all comes together. I'm trying to think here. It really worked out great. Maybe we'll do the AB one more time here. Let's do it on the string section, because I love it so much. We had Rob Moose play strings. I did an arrangement and he came in and just played it beautifully. Very expressive string part here. And we'll AB back and forth between the out of the box summed with mic preamps and all that stuff, and the in the box version summed digitally but using hardware inserts to access the same outboard gear for the processing. So here's out of the box. In the box. Out of the box. In the box. So there you have it. You know, out of the box sounds a little more vintage. In the box sounds a little more modern. It's probably, you know, a matter of taste at a certain level. I'm really happy with this thing. If people are interested in building one, you know, shoot me a comment or something and I can send you a link to the little formulas for calculating the resistors and stuff like that, and see if I can help you out at all if you actually want to go down this road. It's been great for me. I'm sticking with it for a while. So I hope that was interesting for you. It was fun to go through this again and, you know, and do this comparison. There was one thing in there that I forgot to pull up because, okay, we got to do this. I'm sorry. I'm so terrible at hosting shows. This is a disaster, but the information is more important than whether I'm good at this or not. Okay. So at a certain point in this process, I was trying to figure out, like, why is this different? And I thought there may be a degradation happening from all of the additional conversions that are happening, you know, because, like, it gets converted when it comes into the computer, then it comes out, you know, the drums get converted again, and then they, you know, they would have to come back in, then they get some with the music, and then it comes out again if I want to compress all the music with the Unfairchild, and then if that all gets summed together with the vocals, it goes out and goes to a tape machine. So it's getting converted like 4 or 5 times from digital back to analog and back to digital, back to analog. And I thought maybe that's the problem. So I did an experiment. Great way to try and figure out what's going on. And so what I did was I had one of the drum mics come out of the computer. I'm trying to set up a good loop here. I think that's right. And so I did it with just one conversion, which is what it would be with the summing mixer, where it just goes out one time, all this stuff happens in the outside world, and then it comes back in. And so here's this one drum mic going through just the one conversion. Okay, and then I did it 4 times. So it came out of the computer and it just went out directly back into, you know, the same converter, then out again, then back in, then out again, then back in, 4 times, which represents more what would happen if I actually did all of this stuff with hardware inserts and summed in the computer. So this is 4 conversions. And then I decided, fuck it, let's go all the way. Let's do 20 conversions. Let's see what happens with that. I want to see what this converter really sounds like. Let's just multiply it on itself and see what we get. So this is it going out and coming back in 20 times on this, you know, Antelope Orion converter. Okay, so now I'm just going to switch between them, one after the other. Here's one conversion. Four conversions. 20 conversions. And this was kind of the surprising thing. I don't know if I hear any difference in there. I don't know that I could pick out the 20 conversion one from the one conversion one. They don't sound any different to me. So I was really surprised by that. I thought that, these digital conversions had more degradation to them than that. But it turns out that's not it. And so I think, really this is, it's the same old story. It's that the thing that we love about the analog world is the things that the analog world is adding. It's not that the digital is actually making things worse. It's that the digital is not adding things, and the analog world is adding things that makes things more musical. So I was actually kind of relieved to hear that 20 conversions with with a, A to D converter is still not really that audible to me. I don't know, maybe you guys could hear it, but didn't seem like a problem to me. So there you go. I actually covered everything I want to cover. I'm done talking about summing mixers now, and hopefully I didn't bore everybody to death with this one, but it was a fun project for me. I hope you enjoyed it. All right, I'll see you next time. Bye.
You put the who's in on the whatsy, attach the whatsy to the whoosie, connect the thingamajig to the thingamabob, and that'll make the whatchamacallit go. You hook the gidget to the gadget, adjust the gadget to the gidget, unhook the dingly dang from the diddly doo.